And blessings, everyone. Welcome to another episode of The Calling. I am so happy to be in this episode with my dear, beloved, long-time friend, Sophia Sundari, which in my heart eyes is a walking legend. I'm having the privilege to be part of her life. She is a part of my life for, I don't know, around 15 years. More or less, if we can count something like that. And she's a wonderful lover, a wonderful teacher, a wonderful guide. And I experience you, Sophia, your presence in... There were a talk about indigo children years ago. Those indigo children are now indigo adults. And I've seen that in you from the first time that I've seen you. An indigo child, a crystal child, and now a crystal woman leading with this clarity, with depth, beyond the common frequency. Welcome.
Thank you so much for this beautiful welcome. It means so much to be seen by you and to have you in my life, and just love you so much. I'm so grateful for all the incredible adventures we've had together. And this also feels like another adventure.
Yeah. I do feel that our life together is like a dance. Mm-hmm. We dance with each other. We show up in different moments. And sometimes it feels like we're doing the same movement. And sometimes like a dance, we change roles. But it is so beautiful to have this type of relationship with someone that is so open and so active, so devotional, so connected, so thriving for the truth and for the highest truth, for the highest frequency, and to walk next to someone like that. It's always it's a treasure. It's a blessing. I'm enjoying my life next to you.
Thank you. I feel once we taste the nectar, then you become drunk and you cannot help but yearn to be with the divine. And then we recognize each other because we are just drunkards, mystics who just breach those realities. And especially that I feel that for a lot of people who have a very strong spiritual connection, they don't want to do things in the world. It's the nectar is here. Why bother doing things? But I feel that's what keeps bringing us together, is that we both also have a very strong sense of purpose here, have a very strong sense of actually, yeah, to maintain the fire of the will in the manifest reality.
Yeah, the holy fire. The fire that gave this breath, the fire that gave this heart, the fire that created this world. And when you... So I know your history in a way, and I know your original shift. The first shift came from actually being a lawyer into starting following your heart. And since then, I'm seeing you again and again and again through valley and mountain high, following your heart. What leads you? How does it feel from within?
It really feels like surrender. Because if I were to try to imagine my life like 15 years ago, I would have never come up with anything close to what I'm experiencing. I wanted to be happy. Yes, I wanted to be wealthy. Yes, I wanted to do something meaningful, but I could have never, ever put a goal or make a plan or make a vision board or anything like that. And I feel that from the moment that my best friend died from drug overdose, that was such a big awakening for me, and it put me into such a stressful situation that activated a very familiar scenario, because I grew up in a very stressful situation in a very chaotic environment. And so that death put me right into that state, and I also managed to burn through a lot in that state. So I was living completely unconscious life. I had questions about who are we? What is this life? What is my destiny? What is my true path? But still, I was living a very disconnected and unconscious life. And then with that death, it gave me life. It shook me up with that unexpected thing. And I, the way I showed up, even in that death portal, talking to his family, organizing things, it's some invisible force took over. Because I feel like the pressure was so strong, so something had to pop. And I feel from that point on, that was already towards the end of my career. The career was just 2 years, but still, then I worked another year, and then that was the completion. And then I discovered the spiritual path, and so many questions were answered, and I understood why he was addicted to heroin, because he was telling me, you never tried, you will never know. And then I was like, he was looking for God, actually. That's what he wanted. And when I had my first spiritual experiences in meditation retreats and where we met in Thailand, I was like, okay, I get it. I didn't need to try that, but I tasted this nectar and I understand. And from that point on, it was such a homecoming. There's nothing else I can dedicate my life to. That's it. This is not a fantasy. It's not a concept. It's something that there was a direct experience of. And since then, I offered my life. I created this consecration ritual for myself, consecrate my life in service to love, in service to the divine. And I feel like I go where surrender takes me. And I could have never imagined that surrender would take me into this way. I thought surrender will take me to Himalayas somewhere, living in isolation. But surrender takes me into being a multimillionaire and having global impact and having incredible success and only just getting started. So quite fascinating.
Yeah, I started to write a post today. And one of the things that I was writing there is that energy is not something that we can reproduce or recycle or recreate. We cannot. We can recycle matter. We can recycle. It came with a conversation that Yuan and I had this morning. And we were speaking about how we create energy, because you cannot, it needs to come from somewhere. It is always here, but something navigates this energy to become alive. And in this conversation, one of the things that Yuan was saying that it's like a pressure. You create a certain pressure and you learn gradually in your mastery how to create a certain pressure that creates a movement. It is our role in life to keep that movement alive and to keep this sensation alive all the time as fresh energy can come through this portal, because it's so easy to search for either alternatives or a demi type, something similar, almost that, but not the real thing. And also, it is very easy to fall into numbness and into stagnation, where you don't feel vital, this divinity awaken within you, right? You can feel that. I can hear that from the story.
Yeah, absolutely. I feel with the numbness, it's literally a disease of humanity, that we lose this sensitivity, and then it shows up as tension in the body, it shows up as belief systems, it shows up as conditioning, all these layers, but actually it's just like us being contracted, and like human experience in itself is like a contraction. To come into the body, we already contract. But then we contract more and more because we forget who we are. And in the remembering, then this relaxation happens and the pleasure happens. And then the natural orgasmic states happen as well. This is quite fascinating. We get to live a life full of pleasure in the embrace of the eternal.
Yeah, one of the things that I feel about success is how much pleasure and how much joy can you actually hold. This is success. There's so many ways to say it, but it's staying in this place of joy, staying in this place of fulfillment, of realization, of luminosity, of pleasure, of aliveness.
Yeah. And even more, what I find that at some point there has to come a moment that we realize that to hold it, we cannot hold it in the way that we hold other things. We cannot hold it like I'm holding it. But there's rather a relaxation into being held.
Yeah. I love this description. It's another way of being, it's another way of holding. It's a way of being held.
Yes.
It's a way, yeah, of you becoming, you're not holding space, you are becoming the space. So what is for you this quality inside of you? How do you feel it inside of you? This devotion, this flame, this holy flame, this passion. How do you feel it?
I love this question. So I find that something that's really paradoxical about my path is that there exists this big surrender together with incredible willpower and this fire that we talk about that then makes me keep on keeping on. And how I experience it is that there's just no other option. I don't even perceive myself as being courageous or brave or confident. There's a certainty. I know where I'm going. It's clear to me, daylight, and that's it. It doesn't require from me to build an identity and get confident in that identity and something like that. It's just very clean, very simple. I know what this life is about for me, and that's it. It's very clear, very simple.
If you are to guide, the common, we can say, either people who are moving in life and having those questions of what is my purpose, or people who are so awakened spiritually and at the same time feeling that it is all here, it is all done, so egoless means I do not exist. What would be your guidance to those situations? What do you feel that you experience inside of you that can share light?
So can you say again, so there are those two polarities, yeah? Some people just go, I want to be egoless, and other people get so preoccupied with worldly accomplishments.
Yeah.
That's the, and what's the...
Yeah, because I do with you, you have this beautiful cocktail, like beautiful nectar by itself, where there is a combination of, I feel divinity passing through me, I'm in full surrender, and while I'm in full surrender, I'm running forward. Mm-hmm. So it's a beautiful mixture of spirit and matter. It's a beautiful mixture of purpose, an acknowledgement of a higher purpose, and a delivery of that higher purpose. Something in you is such a beautiful messenger. And when I look many times, people are coming also to me with questions about my purpose. How can I fulfill my purpose? And the most of the scenarios that you see, it's either people who cannot tap into their inspiration, into the feeling that they are worthy, that it's already here, or people who feel that it is so here that there's no need for anything more. For this, or this, or both, what would be your medicine? What do you feel that you can inspire them?
I feel like both are true in a way. And because on one hand, it is all here. Everything is already here. There's nothing to accomplish. It's just here. There's no separation. There's only one of us. It's all already done. And it's also true that it's not the ego who has to do it. It's like we cannot do it from the personality. We cannot do it from just like just deciding, oh, I'm going to do it because other people are doing it. It seems to be working for me, so let me do it. It also cannot be. It cannot come from this contraction. It cannot come from grasping. Whenever in my life, and I'm saying this because I've done that also, because sometimes some worldly goals, some payments that have to be fulfilled when I was having the scheduled payments for my apartment coming in every month, I was experiencing this grasping, and I felt that it's impossible to create from grasping. I tried, it really did not work. I had my lowest months in business ever when I was coming from that place. And quickly I realized that it's completely against the very thing I'm made of. It cannot come from grasping. To create really magnificent things on this planet, in our lives, it cannot come from grasping, because it cannot come from personality. It can only come from the magnificence that is the divine. And so within that, it sounds like a paradox to the mind, but when we go higher in the consciousness, we see that it's not a paradox, but it's a perfectly orchestrated way of the universe, that we get to be this big space, this loving space, remembering that there's no separation, no distance between you, what you desire, but at the same time, you open even a little bit more, and then a little bit more, and then you find the power that moves you, that makes you unstoppable. So it's like in the openings, it's like you crack, and then there is this force that goes through. That's how I experience it. Because you cannot create this force, you cannot, you know, fake it. But it's like you have to yearn so much. It's like the flower. It grows, and it looks so beautiful, so delicate, but it has a massive root system. But it also goes, and what does it take from a flower to actually open to its beloved? Because it wants to be kissed by the sun. Why does it? Because nothing else matters. It wants to be kissed by the sun. That's what makes the flower blossom. That's what gives purpose of life. This is what, it's everything for the flower. And then it has to create all these roots and do whatever it needs to do to get the nourishment it needs. But the goal is this, to open and to be kissed by the light. And so through this, okay, I feel this light, I feel this light. And at the same time, I grow the roots because I really care so much. Somehow, is it a paradox? But it's also seen in nature.
Yeah. And the infinity nature of it, I feel that this is something also to highlight. That there is no point where that love can stop, or divinity can stop, or even life can stop. There's no point. We can have a lot of thoughts of how the world will end, how our life will end, how a relationship will end. And at the same time, we do know that there's no end. There's no stop. There's an opening upon an opening. I heard you and felt you when you were saying you crack even more. And the mind could ask, how do you crack? But it's also, it reminds me of construction where giving birth. You don't need to do anything. You crack and crack even more. It is just happening. It is happening in relationship, it is happening in your creation, in writing books, when you allow this force to pass through you.
Not resist the experience, and even not to resist the resistance, because also I can imagine in the contraction that there is also like a part that, oh my gosh, this is like painful, can it stop? But then, okay, so relax even into that, and stay with it, and okay, you will contract and you will try to resist, but it will still take over. So better give in.
Yeah, it will take over. And yes, better give in. I agree. I experience it less like that, but the same, like the highlight that I want to give here in this conversation for both of us and for those who are listening is that it's not only us that are surrendering, it is spirit passing and us melting in the presence of this truth, the presence of this clear frequency. Where like I feel myself in the presence of God as someone who's melting. My surrender feels more, okay, I'm going to melt also here. I'm going to let go also here. It's a very, I would even say, active surrender. Like with this warm, with this gifts, and I can come sometimes with questions, and I can come sometimes with doubt, and sometimes I will receive answers, and sometimes I will receive silence. And in this presence of silence, I look, be less you. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? Be less you. Yeah. Okay, my. Be less you. Okay, I got it.
And then let you become more you.
For becoming more you. Be less you.
Yeah, that's beautiful.
You know, this,
that's where what I you said there is surrender that feels active, and that's exactly the point that I feel there's a lot of confusion around. That it sounds like surrender is like giving up, and surrender is like doing nothing. But I feel like there's nothing passive about surrender. It takes so much presence. It takes so much dedication. It takes so much fire to actually surrender. And then in that, we become visible. In that surrender, we become visible to the invisible realms. And then there's all the support that comes. And that's why it's so hard to explain it, because we truly experience our multidimensionality and seeing that it seems like it's all my creation, and it is, but at the same time, I am actually in a constant co-creation with the entire existence, and there's so much support.
Sophia, do you feel that inside of you there's a question about humbleness? I will elaborate a moment. May I?
A question around humbleness?
Yes. Because surrender, some people confuse surrender with being lethargic and letting go and not taking ownership and let things be what they are. And there's also another aspect of surrender, which is, I'll be humble, not that I am not meaning, there's no meaning within me, but rather that the I that I am not will be clear, so I that I am will shine. And there's this frequency, a very subtle frequency, that is similar to humbleness, that the arrogance of the mind is not showing up. Arrogance or humbleness is not a question of the heart, although many people can confuse with that, because the only thing that can be arrogant inside of us is our head. Do you feel that inside of you? Because you came from an education and you are Sophia, right?
I feel like there was many years in my life where I was really putting a lot of emphasis on being humble, because I thought that's the right code of conduct. Because as I was growing up, I was told, be proper, yeah, be nice, all those things. And then also with a spiritual upbringing, also those things came up, like with my spiritual studies. Yeah, as a yogi, you want to be humble. And then I realized it's another ego trip. To try to be humble. There's nothing holy or spiritual in trying to be humble. It's just another play that takes you out of surrender and out of what truly matters. Because when you surrender, it does not matter. Humble, schmumble, you do the right thing. How it's perceived by others, because to be humble is normally we do it to stay nice so that others like us, because we like humble people. They're not showing up, they're not taking too much space. What is there not to like about them? They're so modest about their results, what they do for the world. They're so quiet. They're so nice to be around. But it's a strategy to be liked by others. And as long as you're strategizing, you're in your head and you're not in your heart and you're not on your highest path.
I remember one of the first moments that I've seen you breaking through in such a beautiful way was when you started speaking about the wild woman. You were like crazy around her. And yes. From time to time, do you remember that time?
Yes, I had naked pictures on the rocks everywhere on the planet. It was my Instagram back then.
Horns.
Wild hair. Yeah, it was horns, yes.
Yeah, and I felt that she needed to come to life because the good girl was so present, right? The good girl who's doing the right thing, that is walking in the right path, and everything is already mapped out. And then... again, if we speak about the spirit that exists within said, okay, Sophia, we spot you on. We have other plans for you. You need to move some rocks.
Which pissed off a lot of people. And I also lost people out of my life also with my wild expressions. And because that's how I was showing up and also at events. I would show up in a completely see-through red dress to this party with a flogger also. People who feel very intimidated, some curious, but most prefer to keep a distance because you never know what to expect from a wild woman. Of course, it was over the top often, but I needed that. We need sometimes radical things to break through those shells of conditioning. And the nice girl, the good girl, is a big conditioning on this planet.
Yeah. It's boundaries that we're taking on ourselves, which are not ours. We take it. And this is go back to this humbleness in the sense of pleasing, right? And the same quality, the good girl wants to know the map. The good boy wants to know the map, wants to know that it is secure, not to make mistakes, not to fail, not to be bitten, to take the downside.
And normally what it does, then it really criticizes itself. Yeah, the good girl, she's so mean on the inside. She says all the mean things, how you should look, how you should talk, how you messed it up. Oh, it's such a terrible environment to live in internally. And then, yeah, of course, this reflects on the external reality.
Yeah, so it's almost like it's almost like saying there's a mess, whether you like it or not. Even if you're spiritual, even if God is alive within you, even more when God is alive within you, there's a mess. Where would you like to experience that? Where would you like to go through that? And this dynamic, this belief system that we have around this mess is messy by itself. I hear so many people saying that the expression of how you are connected spiritually and how you are awakened spiritually is a representation of your manifestations. And as a spiritual person, I'm asking myself, is that the truth? Because as a mystic myself, and as a person who's surrounded with so many people who are mystics, I'm not sure that my manifestation is a representation of my spirituality. I'm not sure that a spiritual person in high frequency is interested all day long in manifestation, rather accepting that there is a manifestation. It is here already happening. And it is actually the play with it.
Yeah, we get to recognize that obviously everything is our manifestation, but not in the sense that you are sitting there and visualizing it. It's more of a sense that, yes, your reality represents to you what is on the inside. And it's not even good or bad. It's just what it is. You just get a very honest mirror everywhere you look. So beautiful.
But the fact that something may go messy or something will be on the edge or something will be provocative, not necessarily a reflection that this person is disconnected spiritually or this person doesn't have this holy flame awakened within.
No, not necessarily. I agree with you. Because also we have different patterns that are also so interesting, and they are all beautiful in the end. For example, I have a pattern that I've been working on for many years and that I already referred to a little bit, that death of my friend really put me into that pattern as well, which is chaos, to create chaos and then to find myself in that chaos. And sometimes I'm just like, whoa, what is this? Why is all this chaos? And then I would get overwhelmed and get so stressed and get so critical with myself. And I would recognize, wow, I'm creating this myself. Why am I doing this? But then I recognize that I'm doing this because a four-year-old inside of me, that was her reality. And she's trying to recreate that so that I heal. So that I heal those patterns, so that I become more and more free through that. And then now I also see myself sometimes creating chaos, not taking a passport when I go to travel, for example. But then I get to be loving to myself about this. Yeah, okay, I'm doing those things. But so what? I rebook the flight. Oftentimes they just, I don't even need to pay for it. And even if I had to pay for it, so what? What a big mess is that? Okay, I'll just go home, I'll rest a few more hours. And then because in the past I would make such a mess over the mess. But then we always have a choice when to stop the mess. Because we then, with our attitude, our thoughts about the mess, then we just make ourselves suffer. But it is what it is, like you're saying. It's just, this is the reality. And you have a myriad of ways how to react to it.
I don't know if you remember. Do you remember that I shared with you that I have this four imprints of the light activator, people who are working with light and working with energy? Do you remember that?
Yes.
So the fourth type is, I call them the paradise openers. They love drama. They love chaos. They love to create mess. Actually, they need almost to create mess. Because this is part of how they move. And let's say like that, not necessarily they create mess, not necessarily they create drama, But because they have this ability to tap to the next level and tap to the next level, move to the next territory, see those things where people are not seeing them, this speed, this clarity, this boldness, this passing those boundaries are creating a ripple of things that might be breaking down, chaos, drama, etc., etc. But there is a very clear knowing with them that this is where they're heading and this is where we need to touch and this is what we need to do. And as you're speaking about it, I'm saying to myself, this is for sure paradise open air. they open the closest things, they open the place where there's this beauty, this paradise.
Beautiful. Yeah, and that's also such a thing that we develop with time, to see the multidimensionality of everything that's happening, because nothing is black or white, nothing is good or bad. There's this high aspect of it, and this divine madness is right there, and being the most delirious drunkard, it's all perfect. And there is childhood trauma, very real things to address, very real things to heal, and all of that exists in this divine perfection, full spectrum. Full spectrum human, completely divine in its essence, inherently.
And the acceptance of the full spectrum, and the acceptance that the spectrum will get even fuller, will get even wider, will get even more. It's such a beauty. Mm-hmm. My love, I'm so happy that we had a moment here to chat.
Me too, it's such a pleasure.
In the beginning of another conversation. Many times it is happening with you, for me. And when we meet, I'm like, okay, forget about the world.
Yes, we can spiral into infinity.
Thank you so much for being here. Thank you for sharing your wisdom and your beauty. Again, I will say, this is beautiful to see how you are stepping more and more higher and higher. Infinite layers of opening.
Thank you so much. Such a pleasure, you know, to connect and be here together.
This week, when we are recording, the episode of my master's Star Apprentice was released yesterday. And I feel that it's not for nothing that I'm recording with you now. Because some people can listen to conversations and try to grasp some things through their head, some meaning, some words. But the most important thing is there is a frequency that is being created. A certain knowing between you and I that we love the most, we share the most. And I feel that this is a calling for the people who were listening to get the words and to feel Sophia and her beauty, infinity, but also to get the codes and to get the vision, to drink from the frequency of what was shared here today.
Yes. What is most important is actually that which we are not saying, that which is within these words. I love you.
Thank you for being here.